a dramatic reversal from the president of the United States here as he's offering to help this economy drowning in pandemic fatigue. Another note of hope today, 2 million receiving the COVID vaccine is an underestimate, says a top Trump administration health official. But the good news seemingly ends there. Pictures of crowded airports remind us of a public health failure and prompt new warnings of a dramatic post-holiday surge.
We very well might see a post-seasonal, in the sense of Christmas, New Year's surge. And as I've described it, as a surge upon a surge. I share the concern of President-elect Biden that as we get into the next few weeks, it might actually get worse.
Next fall, Dr. Fauci says, is when we can start thinking about a return to normal if all goes according to plan. But 1.3 million Americans passing through airports runs counter to the A's and B's and C's of staying safe. The consequences are easy to see. A new CNN analysis shows the share of ICU patients with COVID-19 is on a straight line up, from 16% of patients in September to nearly 40 now. That stimulus bill the president signed does give more money to hospitals, $3 billion worth, but that is well short of the original $35 billion that lawmakers had wanted and what hospitals say they need to keep up with the flood of patients. Let's go straight to CNN's Phil Mattingly. And Phil, the president changed his mind last night after nearly tanking a deal which was negotiated by his own negotiators. The obvious question is why?
Yeah, Brooke, it's been a bit of a head-spinning couple of days. This one person who has been in communication with the president over the course of the last week told me just flat-out head-spinning. That was what he said, head-spinning over the course of the last couple of days. What it took, according to people who were involved in this process, is a heavy, heavy push by some of the president's few remaining congressional allies. That's Kevin McCarthy, the House Republican leader. That's Lindsey Graham, the South Carolina senator. And also, perhaps most importantly, David Perdue, the Georgia senator who has an extremely crucial runoff race in just a couple of days. He met in person with the president. He spoke by phone with the president. All of them urging the president to come on board with this, trying to emphasize his legacy, but also trying to emphasize the need in the economy right now for this money, the need for vaccine distribution funds, and the need, as you noted, for hospitals as well. I will note, the president is claiming victory because he got a few items here. He says he's going to introduce a formal rescissions package request. In other words, try and impound some of the spending that's in that bill, the bill that he called pork, which was, frankly, what his administration had asked for. That means nothing. He will be out of office before it could actually have tangible effect. He also is getting two procedural votes in the Senate, one on the expansion of those direct payments from $600 to $2,000, and one on something related to online liability, the Section 230 he always talks about. That as well is just procedural votes. So what did the president actually get out of this? To be frank, Brooke, nothing really.
Well, what about what the American people can get out of this? Just quickly, I just have this man, Matthew Cox, on the mind after talking to him and how he's hurting, and he's one of millions. When will Americans know when the checks get cut and head to them?
Look, so were it not for the president's delay, the checks would have started to go out today, according to the Treasury Department. So the direct payments of $600 will start to go out probably the first week of the new year. I think the big question right now is how quickly can the two unemployment programs that expired on December 26 get back up and running? And I think the concern there is that on a state-by-state basis, sometimes the technology isn't great. We remember it back in March and April where they had difficulty. And also, some people had their benefits expire and they will have to reapply. So I think there's some hope right now that that can move quickly, at least over the course of the next couple of weeks. But something to keep in mind, not only was the direct payment check skipped for a week, not only were unemployment benefits skipped for a week, the additional $300 federal benefit that was added as part of this bill also skipped for a week. Those are not retroactive. I will say one thing to keep a very close eye on today, Brooke, the House of Representatives this evening is going to vote on what the president asked for, expanding those $600 direct payments to $2,000. I am told with Republican support that is expected to pass. That will put the onus on the United States Senate. Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell has not committed to holding a vote yet. However, the president announced that was part of the deal. How that happens, how that plays out, where Senate Republicans, Brooke, are very much not aligned with the president on this, it's going to be very interesting to watch. It's possible, maybe not probable, that $600 could turn into $2,000, which would be one heck of a New Year's gift for a lot of people.
It would indeed. Phil Mattingly, thank you. very much. To COVID specifically, vaccines, they are on the way back to normal, and progress so far is promising. Two different vaccines are already being administered to patients, at least 2 million people getting vaccinated thus far, and another vaccine maker announced the start of its phase 3 trial this morning. CNN's Kristen Holmes joins me now. And Kristen, optimism from a top administration health official on that 2 million number.
That's right, Brooke. And unfortunately, though, it's optimism that isn't shared by a lot of the healthcare providers that I'm talking to. Remember, the administration set this goal of 20 million doses administered by the end of the year. That's 20 million shots in arms by the end of the year, which now, of course, is in 4 days. And over the weekend, we saw this 2 million number. It came from the CDC, and that clearly falls well short of the 20 million. Now, Admiral Brett Giroir, he is the Assistant Secretary of Health for HHS. He says he believes this is an underestimate. Take a listen.
The 2 million number is probably an underestimate. We've distributed to the states 10.8 million doses. That 2 million number is delayed 3 to 7 days. 20 million doses will be distributed to states by the first week in January. That's where we are. Probably another 30 million doses in January, another 50 million doses in February.
So while, of course, Giroir there is saying that that number is an underestimate, he believes it's actually much higher, it's not going to hit that 20 million mark. And you can see that he's moving the goalposts there. It was 20 million doses into arms by the end of the year. Now it is 20 million doses that'll be distributed, not administered, by the first week in January. And there's a lot of concern here among healthcare workers who believe that the system that's already been slowed down is going to be bogged down even further when people start getting those second doses next week.
Yep. I want to ask you something unrelated, just while I have you, because in New York, Kristen, there is this criminal investigation into a county health provider accused of illegally obtaining the COVID-19 vaccine. What's going on?
Yeah, that's right. We believe this might be the first crime related to the COVID-19 vaccine. The information we have comes from the state health department, from the health commissioner there, who released a statement saying that in one county, they were aware of reports that a network had fraudulently obtained COVID-19 vaccine, transferred it to facilities in other parts of the state in violation of the state guidelines, and diverted it to members of the public. So there is an infancy investigation going on right now, according to New York State officials. But this is something that healthcare providers have been long concerned about, that there were not enough precautions in place to stop something like this from happening, and also concerns that there will be more theft and potentially lead to a black market for the vaccine. Brooke?
Kristen Holmes, thank you so much. I'm hoping they'll all be looking out for that. Always people looking to do bad things with some optimism here. With me to discuss all of this, Dr. Rob Davidson. He's an emergency room physician in West Michigan. Dr. Davidson, good to see you as always. I want to go back to that 2 million number that Kristen was just reporting on from the CDC. You know, the current administration was very optimistic about how many vaccines they'd be able to administer by the end of the year. They promised 20 million, and nearly 2 million have been administered. Your assessment of that number, A, and B, just what does that tell you about the timeline in terms of, you know, regular healthy folks can get vaccinated?
Yeah, you know, I don't have any privy information as to exactly how many doses there are, but it certainly seems that it's less than they originally anticipated, and they didn't perhaps game this out as well as they should have before the vaccine came online. Given everything that happened with this administration over the past, you know, 10 months or so, it certainly would seem that perhaps another administration might have rolled this out better. But, you know, either way, we're going to have to keep doing the not so hard work, but has been difficult in this country, of getting people to wear masks, getting people to, you know, socially distance. That's going to have to happen for the next 6 months anyway, because it's going to take that amount of time to get enough people vaccinated, especially if the number is perhaps going up from 70% to perhaps 80% as these more contagious strains start to spread throughout the communities. We just need to continue to do that and message on that.
Speaking of shots in arms, you got your vaccine, dose number 1 of 2 over the weekend. We've got the video representing Michigan loud and proud there with the T-shirt, Doc. How was it? Any side effects? How do you feel a couple days later?
Well, I just got it yesterday, about 24 hours ago, and, you know, a little soreness in the arm. I just got done working 5 night shifts in a row. I'm almost 50 years old, so I'm not sure if a headache is from that and fatigue is from that or it's from the shot, but certainly extremely tolerable. And so I think it's our job, my job as a healthcare provider, others' jobs, the folks in the media's job to continue to tell people, listen, this thing is safe. Despite a certain headline here or there about people having allergic reactions, you know, people get allergic reactions with penicillin at a far higher rate, mm-hmm. and we don't see headlines about that every day. So we need to continue to spread the message that we need to do this.